There's another story I'm going to tell you about a man that I met who was in the mafia, and then eventually he was put in prison, and they said it was the best thing that happened to him. In the course of my journey, I was introduced to a man who was a reformed character, and it's an amazing story of the alchemy of life, you know, and people who are high and mighty that get brought down to book. You know, somebody introduced me to this person around probably 2006, 2007, something like that. Anyway, cut a long story short, at the time I was researching into, you know, a little while back into the whole 70s phenomenon. And what they have tried to do, they tried to nip in the bud that people were awakening at that time. So they used hippies they tried to smear and to change the perception of what a hippie was. Most hippies were about peace, love, understanding, freedom, you know, sharing, equality, harmony between all races, all people. And it was bad for the devil. It was bad for their agenda. So what they did is they brought in the electronic movement to robotoid people. All the men used to have long hair at the time. You know, it was very natural. You know, we as a people, we used to have natural hair, afros. Then what they did to our community, they brought in the hair relaxer so that most black people, the birth of a show called, what was that? Soul Train.
Soul Train.
I remember that. Advertisements. Yeah, they did all these deals with these companies that did hair relaxing, which is to make your hair straight, right? So that they would stop us being natural people, yeah? Because your hair is like an antenna, especially for the melanated man and woman of Afro-Caribbean or Afro-American. Your hair is an antenna. It's part of your spirituality, you know? And so what they wanted is they wanted to remove us from our sacred being. That's where there's a story of Samson. There's some symbolism behind the importance of the hair. God gave us hair for a reason. Obviously, some of us lose our hair, and that's fine as well. There's nothing wrong with that. But what I'm saying is that they try to chemically alter it so that we would lose our identity as a people as well. And more... You know, that's why now you'll see Beyonce's blonde. You'll see, you know, people. I've seen cases of people going to backstreet companies to have their eyes removed to make their eyes blue. Instead of accepting having brown eyes, they don't want brown eyes anymore because that's part of the programming. And a lot of the, you know, Caucasian men who grew their hair long, they all cut their hair. They started looking androgynous as far as kind of like makeup was concerned with the advent of electronic music. It was a whole Tavistock Institute situation that kicked off in the 70s, and it basically, they wanted to shut it down. They knew we were waking up as a people, and where we are today is because of what they implemented at that time. So I just wanted to put that in.
Absolutely. I can add something to that. The idea of the awakening was to end wars and to end this discrimination stuff. Well, they make their living on war, and they have to have discrimination. That's why they're using it right now in the United States. They're fomenting a race war so that they can divide the people and keep them occupied with one another while they do their nastiness. But they did.
Yeah.
They totally disrupted the civil rights and the anti-war movement,
and they killed all the heroes, Hendrix and all those people. They were all assassinated. If you go on to, there's a film called Behind the Doors, or is it called Behind the Doors? Behind the Doors. YouTube it. Just type it in, Behind the Doors, I believe that's what's called, and it shows you what really happened behind Jimi Hendrix, Janis Joplin, and Jim Morrison from the Doors. It's quite an important documentary to see how, you know, because they were very instrumental in, you know, the awakening of people at that time.
They were.
So they wanted them removed.
They were.
And
Not...
it was apparently, these are the files of a man who was part of the FBI, who saw the whole thing engineered of how they were killed, and he kept the file in a secret place. And when he was eventually killed, or I don't know how he died, there was some form of foul play in his death anyway. And I believe his son got the film made, and it shows you the kind of synchronicity and the CIA and FBI being involved in their assassinations. And they were targeted, basically, you know, because they had an influence on, and obviously on the general populace. And they want to use, whoever's in the general populace has to be singing their tune and not the tune of, you know, the Most High God, which is peace, love, freedom for all of us, truth, honesty, being fair, being just to one another, you know. They didn't want that.
No.
So, yeah, so that's an interesting one to look out for if anybody is interested in this kind of thing. It also is a very good, film to see to understand the background of targeting. Another one to see is called Antitrust. Antitrust. It was made, I believe, in 2002. Could have been 2001. But it's about young genius software engineers and how they get targeted and murdered. And it's just a brilliant expose on the whole thing. It's a movie. It's actually a movie. But it shows you what really happens. That is real. When people contact me who are targeted, I give it to them to watch, and they come back to me in tears. And they say, oh my God, that's my life. Oh my God, you know. So I say to anybody who's interested in this area, and if you're not, you should be, because it affects you in one way or another. It doesn't matter if you're not creative. You could have a daughter that's creative, and they could kill her, or a son. You know, if you, you know, if you have a family member, you know, a friend, or, you know, if you're a consumer, you buy these products, it affects you. You know, you could be trapped in a false flag by these people, you know, like many people have been caught up in. So it affects everybody. Everybody is affected. Some people say, oh, that's your problem. No, it's our problem. It's our problem, and there's 7 billion of us. If 7 billion of us can't deal with 1% of the population, that's when we got problems, in my mind. If 7 billion people who create music, you know, innovations and all sorts of amazing things which we put out there every day of the week cannot deal with a rogue 1%, we have got a problem. I do not believe that. I believe that as 7 billion people, we can deal with this and we can get them out, dealt with properly, fairly, justly.
We just need to wake. We need to, at this point, people need to come forward, and you're a beacon for them now, which is wonderful. People need to come forward. This is a slave trade. Honestly, we work with Abraham and Ella. It's a slave trade. When they took Renetta's ideas for the Kindle, and those things are made by slaves. They take them to China.
Absolutely. It's a slave on every side. On the manufacturing side, this is the thing. I'm going to show you how it works properly. Let me first go a little bit more into the story, then I will tell you what I discovered.
Okay.
Obviously, to put the case together, that's when I started to go into research mode, and that's when I started to realize what kind of hell I had been walked into, because I had no idea that this existed.
We're all ears.
Sorry?
We're all ears. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. Thank you. I'm just running my mind back to where we were in the story so far. So, I'm basically, at this time, I'm receiving threats, and I discover not just that my name has been given to a blonde girl, I realize they've created a program about what they were doing to me. It's been launched on the BBC. I didn't know the BBC was a cult, a satanic cult. I didn't know that, you know. And like this friend of mine, she was saying to me, oh my God, this is like Rosemary's Baby. She said, this is because everywhere I was going, they were all in on it. There was only few people, you know, I don't know if you've ever seen that movie, Rosemary's Baby. Yeah. She goes from place to place to place to for help, and they're all part of this cult everywhere she goes. And it was like that, but I was lucky. I had a doctor who happened to his daughter. He was a good man. And so he saved my life, that man. He really did. There's a number of people that went out of their way to save my life. They really did. And they wrote to the key people, the courts, at the right time. You know, when I was being sent death threats, these people notified people in departments. And, you know, they have... doctors have weight, you know. The doctor writes, this woman's life is in danger. She's receiving death threats, you know. She's definitely in danger. It has weight, you know. And so I was lucky. I had a lot of credible people around me that were fighting my corner as well. And so, you know, there was a long record as far as, like, the my health, because eventually I started blacking out. The enormity of the situation was just so shocking to me. I started getting vertigo. It started with vertigo. And I would be walking, and then I felt like I was walking kind of, and the ground was moving underneath me because I was feeling sick. I just couldn't believe what was happening. That these vans, every day I looked out my window, these vans were there. Everywhere I went, they followed me. People took photographs of me in the street as I walked down the street, and it was like I was no longer a normal person. I couldn't just go and buy milk like everybody else. And I was like, what has happened to my life? And people want to be famous. They have no idea what these famous people go through. It's not fun to be famous. They sell it like it's a good thing. All these people are desperate for fame. You want to go around with people photographing you all day long. And you can't go from A to B without somebody telling you some crap. That's no fun. You know, people have been brainwashed so badly by that industry. Young people have been made to think this is gold. You know, it's all glistening and it's all done with bells and whistles, and it's all a mirage that leads to nowhere. It leads to a murder machine. That's where it leads these young people. It doesn't lead them nowhere where they're living their life purpose. Everybody's life has come here for a purpose. People have to find out, what is that purpose? Why did you come here? Not, oh, I just want to be famous. For what? For doing what exactly? What did you help somebody do? You know, people need to be woken up out of this nonsense. Yeah, so, you know, I started being followed and I was like, oh my goodness gracious. And for me, because it was a terror campaign, for me, I became furious. It did not have the desired effect that they wanted. They wanted to make me feel like, oh my God. Yeah, it did for some people around me, but it made me angry like you can't believe. I was furious. There was not even a word in the dictionary for how I felt. I used to run through my head scenarios where I'd tear that woman apart for what she was doing to me. I thought, you evil, evil woman, how could you do this to somebody because you want my work? So I thought, no way. You know, I did have people, a couple people came to me and said, you know what, Sam, you're gonna spend a long thing. If you wanna, what they call on the street, a long thing. He said, this is a long thing that you're dealing with. The reality is that if you go through the judiciary, they ain't going to give you justice. You need somebody to go around to that guy and tell him what time it is. And I said, you know something? I don't want to do that. I believe in the law. I believe in justice. And I believe that's the way that I'm supposed to do it. Whatever come what may, that is where I will put my energy. So I put my energy into studying the law. So while this is kicking off around me, I'm getting death threats on a daily basis. I'm also studying the law. Lisa gave me all her law books. I have criminal law books, intellectual property law. I've got the law of torts. Law of torts, contract law, media law, criminal law. I mean, you name it. I ate those books for supper. But I was a big reader anyway. I used to read 10 books, you know, I think a week or something like that. I would have them open from all 10 opened in sequence, one after the other. And I would read them, like, all 10 at the same time, you know.
Yeah.
This is all in my teens and my 20s. I studied music. I studied all on my own, you know. And so I've always been somebody, because in my chart, I'm a combination of earth and water. So earth, you know, water makes the earth grow things, isn't it, in the soil. So I'm very, one of the things that is very much part of my chart is that I'm very good at teaching myself something. You know, I can teach it to myself very quickly. And that's a very indigo thing. I discovered I was an indigo much later when I was in hiding. I didn't know about indigos beforehand. But later on, when I started seeing the characteristics, I realized that I was one of those. I'm more of a starseed because starseed children are born in the 60s, like people like JFK, Malcolm X, Mother Teresa, she's a famous starseed. There's many of us, you know. I'm sure you're indigos as well. Definitely twin flames, that much I do know.
Thank you.
But, so anyway, I actually studied law while this was kicking off around me. So they actually put an operation. My house was bugged, broken into, was being broken into regularly. It was bugged. Then they started with these bailiffs. They would turn up. First, they'd turn up at like early in the morning and they'd put a letter in saying that I owe £200. Then they'd show up like again at maybe 11 o'clock and it would be gone up to about £600. Then they'd come back before 2 o'clock and then they'd put another one and now it's something like £2,000. And then they come back again. And this is literally every day. And so I ended up with all these different like bailiffs notice letters, you know, until it got to a fever pitch where, you know, they started saying they were going to put me in prison and all this sort of stuff. So I used to go to the, there's a one-stop service, and I went to the local one-stop service for the council, and I said, listen, I'm getting these letters through the door. I don't owe anybody anything. These are my official letters to show you that I don't owe anybody any council tax. Because what they use is they use legitimate kind of so-called legitimate mechanisms to invent a reason to come to your house. So they won't just like this is desperate when they send a man, obviously he's got workman's clothes, so he's disguised as some workman. But the reality is that man was sent, okay, because I'm doing interviews and things like that. But, you know, as it starts off, the way they started off is that they send the bailiff and you know you don't owe anybody any money, but these people are coming like 5 times a day, you know what I mean? And they're banging your door, they're trying to get into your house, they're trying to find a legitimate mechanism to get in and to get into your neighbors' houses as well. So it's not just your house, they're trying to get into everybody's house because they want to get to you, they want to get to the people who are trying to, you know, in the building so that, you know, if you go and visit them, you know, they'll stop them from allowing you to visit them. You know, because I had neighbors, everybody in the building knew what was happening to me. And they were phoning up the police as well, because they were having the hassle. Their doorbell was being rung. And it was a nightmare for them too. So I went to the one-stop services and the young lady that was there, she put a message onto the, when she saw that this was like wrong. She just put a message on the computer. She said, look, this woman doesn't owe anybody any money. She's got bailiffs coming out to her door. Stop the bailiffs. Stop sending her any messages. And she left that on the system. She called up the bailiffs in front of me and she said, this is Westminster City Council. Do not send any more bailiffs around to Miss Seven's house. She doesn't owe any money. Okay. And then the bailiffs was quiet. When I rang them, they were like a dog on rabies, you know, really foaming at the mouth, screaming at me on the phone that they were going to do this, that, and the other to me. When she rang them, they were humbled, you know, and she told them to stop. Anyway, come the following morning, it starts again. The letters are in the door. They're ringing my doorbell nonstop and everybody else's doorbell trying to come in. And that they're going to, what did they say? I've got all the, if you go on the Farrell report, you can see there were hundreds of these letters. Because it was like all day, every day. I had like a pile, massive pile. And eventually I go back to the lady and I say, look, they're coming back again. I'm sick of this now. And she said, you're joking. She said, I put a notice on the computer. When she went back on the computer, the notice had been removed. Somebody removed it. Jeez. And so she said, okay. And then she rang up the bailiff. She said, look, I've told you to stop going round to her house. She doesn't owe you any money, blah, 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 blah. And so the bailiff obviously said okay or whatever to her. And then come the following morning, they'd be back again. So no matter what she did, they just come back. And it was like this from early 2004 all the way up to the time that I ended up in hiding. And but as the time became more and more, it got more aggressive, it got more violent as time started being death threats. Then, you know, before they used these bailiff's letters as an excuse, because it gives them a legitimate kind of so-called legitimate reason to be on trespassing on your premises, because they've got this letter in their hands, even though they faked it, and it's fraud. It's complete fraud, because there's no money owing in any shape or form. It's their way of having a reason to torment you on a daily basis. So I go back to the lady and she says, look, somebody's got it in for you. I said, I know who it is. I know who it is. And that's when I started realizing you've got to take these proceedings because these people are going to kill you. So anyway, I started getting messages about Sophia Stewart being in America. She had a case. So people were saying to me, because by that time, I'd gone to Tamsin Allen. I called up Tamsin Allen from Bynum and Partners. They are the MI5 assassination bureau, right? And they're all part of the network. But they deal with the terrorist side of it, right? I would say Russell's deals with the IP crime. They're all in it together, but it seems to me that they all have different roles. They've all been allocated specific roles. And when it comes to Tamsin Allen, what happened in that case, remember I told you that I wrote a book?
Yes.
Now, before I went to Tamsin Allen, one of the things I always do is I write a contract, confidentiality contract, before a disclaimer, which has terms and conditions of me showing that evidence. Because by that time, I realized that, there's no lawyer that's going to take my case. What happens is that your name gets flagged up. So automatically your name will be on some sort of a register somewhere along the line. And, you know, you ring up and, you know, it's probably got a code next to your name or what have you. And so they'll try to get you to attend a meeting so that they can get your evidence. That's how it works. These lawyers are fences for each other.
Right.
They protect each other. They will close ranks on you, and that's what they did to me. So I went to somebody said to me, oh, try Bynum and Partners, because they're sold to the public as a human rights lawyers. They're based in King's Cross, London. And this is the thing, all of these deeply criminal places have these fronts that yep. make it look like they are, you know, for the people, you know, human rights. They couldn't be further from human rights if you made it up. I mean, these people are the most criminal of criminal of criminal, and they are operating on an intelligent side of things. They're in the MI5 side of things, I believe it, because of what happened. So anyway, I agreed to go and see this Tamsin Allen. And I, at the time, I had like a desktop with floppy disks. I was still using floppy disks in those days. And I put the confidentiality agreement, I printed it out so that she would sign it. But in order to be fair, to give her the opportunity, let's say she said, I don't like that clause. I don't agree with that clause. I brought the floppy disk along so that we could amend it straight away, print it out, and then she re-signed it. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
Okay. So she steals the floppy disk.
Oh,
great. Of course, my book is on the floppy disk. Mm. So now my book is being chopped into little bits and pieces. It's sold into all different types of industry, the walk, and it's been given to authors, different famous authors, Faye Weldon, Marion Keyes, what's the other woman that did, Adrian Mole, a whole lot of them anyway, different authors, famous authors, were given a chapter of my book, and they launched a nationwide competition with it called Finish This. That's how satanic it is. It's like, oh, finish this, like yeah. in your face, yeah?
Yeah.
And so she sells it, they sell it as part of that, they fuse it with part of the other work was stolen, and they say 7 easy ways to walk, you know what I mean? So then they launch Britain on the Move, because this book was about giving up transportation and materialism and going on the walk. And it's a whole philosophy, you know, and they stole this. It starts off in a shoe shop in the city, and then it ends up in the outback of Australia, where they give up their passports. They're, you know, they're walking around with a trolley. Shoes are made of tires. It's an amazing story, but it's a true story. And obviously when she stole it and they were chopping it up and selling it as all different things, they made apartments with it, the walk apartments, they opened shoe shops called the walk, you know, they bulldozed the shoe shop where the story is based on, because I basically wrote, I rang up the BBC and I rang up various different people with other witnesses, and we said, how dare you, this is a true story, it's been sold to you by Tamsin Allen. And obviously I confronted Tamsin Allen and I said, return my floppy disk, you've stolen it and you've sold my work. I said, how did my work that was on the floppy disk suddenly end up all over the world? This was a unique story and I could actually prove that it was mine. So what they did, they bulldozed the whole shop. They, not just the shop, all the shops behind it, beside it, they bought the whole land and they just bulldozed. So when I got there, there was nothing standing. That's how heavy this is. They burned down buildings, you know, to cover up their tracks. I used to have my documents like printed in this printers, all my scripts and everything was bound beautifully, you know. And, you know, I had made friends with these people in all these different businesses. So they always made sure they, you know, they would say, oh, give me a fiver or give me a couple of pounds, you know. They knew I was like the kind of struggling artist archetype.
Right.
So I always used to get like, you know, really nice treatment from them. You know, they would do their best to make sure that my things were done with love, you know, and... When I told them, I went in there and I told them it's all been stolen. It's been sold. And one of the guys that was a printer of one of my printers, he said to me, he was like, oh no, that's awful, I'm so sorry, you know, because before the meetings I had more printed up. So when I went back in there, he said, how did it go? What's happening? You know?
Yeah.
And I said, it's all been stolen, you know? And he was like, oh no, I know someone in Channel 4. I'll speak to them and I'll tell them. And then give it a few days later, that shop was bought and shut down.
The print
closed
shop?
Down.
The print shop was?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Even the post office was closed down. Even the post office, everything. The shoe shop was the most aggressive, though, apart from, you know, across the road, they did a false flag across the road from my house, and they burnt the building down. Aww. But, that's on video. That's on video. And you're going to see that that's out there already. I don't know if you've already seen that, but it's already out there. Anyway, so, you know, I start recognizing the scale of this, you know, like to bulldoze buildings down, that's a lot of money involved. That's a lot of people involved. That's a lot. That's not just, you know, we're stealing your work. This is something else now going on, you know. And so these people that they're sending, they're like hitmen, you know, they send them around to terrorize you. But they can't just turn up and so they use the guise of council tax, you owing some fictitious bill that they'll invent on the
right.
spot, you know. So then obviously I started going to the police quite a lot. I had to, because I was being followed. Witnesses were being followed. Our phones were being rerouted to NTL's facilities. So you pick up your phone line and it would say, NTL call center, how can I help you? Something like that,
oh.
you know. And you're just basically, it's your phone line, but your phone has been completely rerouted so that you can't speak to anybody. They take it because you've got to remember this is a telecommunications company. They have satellite, they have surveillance, they have, and this is before the GCHQ was built, you know. And I believe this money is what built the GCHQ because that was them expanding their operations and they expand the covert slave trade and targeting because it is a slave trade, it's domestic terrorism. That's what 7/7 is domestic terrorism. They always blame other people of what they're guilty of themselves. So, you know, they'll say, I'm a lie, you know, and that, like, they'll try to paint themselves as a victim, even though I've got evidence of everything. I do not open my mouth about things that I can't prove. If I can't prove it, I might mention it, that this happened, but I won't say it. Like, I'll say I can't prove it, but if I tell you this is what it is, you know I can back it up, yeah, because this is my life, this is my family's life, this is people's lives on the line right now. There's no time for joking in this situation. So, you know, this thing starts morphing in front of me. I'm being followed everywhere, and, you know, I just start blacking out. I just start, all of a sudden, the vertigo goes into overdrive and I just crash out every so often. I don't get that anymore, I'm fine now, because it takes some time to acclimatize, to develop a thick skin where you just laugh at it, you know, and you just say, thank you for the evidence, you know, I see it as evidence now. Anything they do, it's evidence. You know, and that's the stupidity of these people. They don't recognize, they don't realize. They're trying to intimidate you, but they don't realize they're giving you evidence that you're going to use against them, you know. And because I can actually draw parallels. Because this is all textbook, by the way. It's being carried out systematically with a conspiracy of silence in every department that you will go to. And what happened was, with the scale of the money, because it was sold, we were told at that time 126 countries. But we know that on the 6th of July, it's even the 6th of July, just before I issued proceedings, they launched something called the Bern Convention, which is B-E-R-N-E Convention, which is a treaty regarding intellectual property. and it establishes ownership rights of the creative person. It originally was brought into play in 1889, and I think it was part of when they had the slave trade, like in the 1800s, and they had the abolition movement. A lot of, in the 1700s, the things that we pioneered and created went automatically to the slave master. But then with the Berne Convention, it established the rights of creative people to own their copyright, right? And so, funny enough, this thing, which was launched in 1889, got revived at the time of this crime being done to me, in order to make all the countries that were being sold my work on a level playing field. Are you hearing me still?
I'm hearing you.
Okay.
Yep, we're right with you. I'm fascinated with this. And
okay. It's so quiet. I'm like, okay, I hope
you're still I don't want to interrupt you. I think you're really on a roll. This part two is really impassioned. I'm really impressed with your ability to articulate this and rally people to this atrocity that's not just happening to you, it's happening to all. It's an abomination.
Yeah. It's an abomination to the highest degree. It really is. And so, like I said, but yeah, what happened was, they launched this Berne Convention, and check this out, at the same time, Helen Alexander gets an award for trade. She becomes the first woman to become the president of trade and publishing for the port of whatever. No, that didn't take place in 2004, but in 2004, she's given an award for my work.
Oh, no.
While she is got a murder mission against me and a witch hunt against me and, you know, a terror campaign. This is why she will be jailed. She will never, her name will be spoken about in history books. These people's names, they will mark my word. They'll be in the books so that children will know what happens to people. They will know the evils behind the creative industries, that you do not just go into them with your eyes closed. All the parents who spend vast amounts of money paying for tuition fees, violin lessons, extracurriculum lessons to teach your child to become, to be able to articulate in all sorts of, different skill sets and disciplines, whether it be dance, music, or to be able to, speak the language of love in different ways. And they go to these, people take free jobs to teach their children, to give them special education, to put them in the best universities and colleges, for them to be murdered after they come up with something that these people want. That's what we're dealing with right now. We're dealing with people's lives being in danger right now. And it is right now, they've actually geared the whole industry towards IP crime. That's why you have the iCloud. And if you buy a Macintosh these days, you have to sign up to iCloud. They're making it so that you have to be online, so that they can snap up your stuff. But here's the thing, right now, countries like Germany and Russia, they're now going back to typewriters. They're reverting, not electronic typewriters even, just good old-fashioned typewriters that are, that are analog or whatever, just normal,
Right.
When you buy your printer's ink and you put it back in, we're going back to basics, because what we've created is a monster. Is so wicked. But you see, that monster is about to turn on them in the worst way possible. They have, they thought that they've engineered our demise because they've been getting away with it. But little did they know, the laugh was really on them. Because now that they're exposed everywhere, the whole thing is coming down. We are going to reform the whole situation of how the entertainment industry runs, how business runs, how trade runs. We're going to change the whole damn thing because this is where we are. And this is why they are planning to nuke everywhere. I believe Helen Alexander is behind that because she's the head of governance. She is shadow government. These people hold high positions. Type in her name and you'll see she's the president of industry. She's the president and prime minister and the chief. She's at the top of the Bilderberger chain. She's at the top of the satanic chain when it comes to the economic side of it. And she got her rise to fame from the theft of my work. That's where she got it. You see, there's a saying, who Jah bless, no one curse. In other words, who God blesses, nobody curse. You don't mess with God's people. When somebody has an idea, it comes from the divine. It comes from God. God gives it to that person so that that person can use it as a tool to fulfill whatever purpose they were created to come down here for. Nobody has the right to stop that person from fulfilling that purpose. Nobody has the right to take away somebody's labor. Nobody has the right to expect people to learn to work for nothing. Nobody has the right to threaten to kill people for their intellectual property. Now, this woman, Helen Alexander, Richard Hanna, Christopher Gossage, they think that they have a divine right under the realm of Satan to do what they're doing. But I am here to show them. Words is cheap. Talk is cheap. I don't just talk. I put action. This is why I went through the judiciary, right?
Right.
I don't just talk. I showed them, I will destroy you. And I will destroy every part of your crime syndicate. I will shut it down once and for all. And because of it, they are terrified of me. They want me to be terrified of them, but the reality is that they're terrified of me. Because I believe in truth. I believe in justice. I believe in freedom. I believe in love. I believe in it. And I live for it on a daily basis. And because of that, they want to shut me up and shut me down and send their little creeps to come after me. But they don't intimidate me. They do not intimidate me. This is my purpose. I've come here to fulfill it. Now, to bring you up to speed with what happened to the court case. So we're talking by 2004 to 2005, you're talking trillions of pounds flooding in to the UK, and it created a category which is now known as the super rich. The money was astronomical. People were being bribed 40 times their wages to do their dirty bidding. So these people had fixers within the government, within the police force, within the courts. Everywhere I turned for help, they paid fixers. But you see, when they have their wicked mission, God has another plan. And if you're wired up to God, you will be divinely inspired what to do at all times. And this is what I have trusted my whole journey in this time. I've trusted it implicitly because I really believe, had I listened to my friend who came over before the meeting, the night before the meeting, if you saw the drama that took place, these sort of things don't happen in my life. I don't allow that around my children. People saying they're going to kill themselves and what have. That doesn't happen in my life. I have ordinary people around me. You know, this was a sister that I love. She's German. And she came and said, there's no way I'm going to turn my back on her. But that was a divine situation that was come to stop me. And had I listened to it, I wouldn't have gone. So my antennas are much sharper. So the journey that I've come to today, to even till yesterday morning, I tell you, I heard the Spirit tell me, run! And I ran fast, like Marion Keyes or whatever. And it was her name, Marion Jones, yeah. The runner. Marion Keyes is one of the authors that they gave my work to. Anyway, I bolted it yesterday morning. And it was just like I heard it shout at me, like somebody pushed me in the spirit. They propelled me forward. And I bolted across the road so fast. And I heard the footsteps coming, like marching, like he couldn't run. So he, because it would have been too obvious, you know. So he was picking right. up the pace with his walking, like, oh God, she's getting away, you know, like that. And I tell you, every single time they've tried to do something, the spirit has told me. Even when they came to try to murder me, that's how I went into hiding. So let me talk you up to that, what happened that led up to the bombings.
So, okay. This is the 7/7 bombings. This is the 7/7 bombing?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, the London bombings. This is the truth behind it, and it's the truth. So help me God. God, strike me down if I tell these people a lie on air with people all over the world listening to me. God, strike me down if I lie, right? I'm telling you that because this is how the truth. I have no fear of death. I don't lie. I don't cheat. I don't need to lie and I don't need to cheat. If anybody tells you that there's another story and that I am a liar, you know that person is an agent. If anybody tells you it was done by Muslims, you know that person is an agent because it had nothing to do with Muslims carrying out these things. The Muslims were framed. They were used to be blamed. And if you go onto this, there's a film called Long Kiss Goodnight. Type in, blame it on the Muslims, Long Kiss Goodnight. And you will see that as far as long way back, when they were going to do the Trade Center, they actually have a program where it says, oh, but you can't carry out bombings. What are you going to do? He says, I know what we'll do. We'll blame it on the Muslims. So that has been out there for a long time. It's in a lot of different TV shows. Because one of the things you'll realize is that they always put the truth in TV shows. That was why it was very interesting what you sent me yesterday, Mindy. Mm-hmm. When you send me about that man concerned, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I do.
Where he says about the 2015, the false attacks that are coming. And, you know, they are planning to do it. I believe that man. I believe that man.
Yeah, so do I, unfortunately.
I'm sorry for what I've seen. And because of the fact that they know people are waking up, they're scared now. And these people, they rather nuke everyone than deal with their what's coming at them. This is why people need to take this call, this interview, this what I'm telling you, take it seriously. Spread it around. Know the people's name. Do your research on the case, this case. See who these people are. Helen Alexander, apparently she's part of Nightingale Lodge. It's a female Masonic lodge. She's part of the Bilderberger group. Look into these people. Look into her name. You'll see that she's the head of chief of intelligence units and all the rest of it. Richard Hanna, he has a military background. These are all behind the governments right now. And it's these people who are behind it, right? Who are behind what they're plotting because they know. They're linked to crime syndicate that is widespread. They're part of Agenda 21. They're part of all the smart meters, the smart grid, murder grid. That's what they're about. And mark my words, they are planning to kill people on a grand scale. They're planning to do it soon. This is why I'm coming as a warner. I'm coming as somebody where you can see documented proof who I am. What I'm telling you is the truth. This is not hypothesis. This is not me researching things. This is me living it for the last 12 years with these people. And trust me, everything I'm telling you is the truth. People need to act. People need to. This is why we're calling on lawyers, We need people in the army who are going to be lawyers, who are going to be sheriffs. Okay, well, I'm saying this is evidence. My case is a case that has been through the judiciary. It's been won. I won it. Hands down, there are courtroom audios. The judge is now dead. There's a wake of deaths, suspicious deaths in my case, including both of my parents last year and two of my friends in 2012 on the same day. And these two friends did not know each other. So I issued proceedings on the 5th of August, 2004. And the court gives them 28 days in which to admit it, to defend it, or to counterclaim. So those are your options when you take proceedings or somebody takes proceedings against you. And, you know, obviously they knew I had evidence because I'd gone to see lots and lots of different lawyers, and every one of these lawyers have obviously told them she's got a mountain of evidence against you, you're finished. So they close ranks against me. So all the lawyers, every lawyer that I went to, had obviously, you know, it was almost like they made it law that no lawyer took my case, right? So yeah. I had to take proceeding myself. At that time, I was being followed by helicopters by that time. Not just myself, but also witnesses were, we were being followed by helicopters. I was receiving death threats on a daily basis. And it got basically out of control because as they saw that I had gathered so much evidence, you know, I mean, can you imagine? I didn't know that she received awards for my work. And can you imagine that she was going this far pretending all this stuff? She's now been, you know, knighted as a dame under complete false identity and everything. Can you imagine how she... if she gets found out by the general populace.
Right, she can't have
she's
that happen.
Finished.
Right,
no.
Right. So she'll she's do like, anything. You know,
yeah, she'll do anything to make sure she's now worth billions. You know, she's got billions. They're all billionaires. They've all risen in the ranks. So Christopher Gossage is now a partner after he was just a clerk at the time when I went to Russell's. He was acting for Tony English, who was the lawyer. Out of the law firm, but you know, he represents as a lawyer, but he's actually, his real title when I went there was actually a clerk within Russell's. But you know, within weeks, he's now a partner. To become a partner in a law firm, it takes years.
Right.
You know, anybody that's an attorney in any country in the world will tell you this. It takes you years. It doesn't happen in a fortnight and a few weeks. And with the scale of the money, everybody just rose to the ranks. At Tamsin Allen, who stole my book, she became a partner. She's now called a super lawyer based on this, all on the sale of my work. You know, they now move in, they become the shadow government. They're right at the top of the tree, but nobody knows them. Jeffrey Beinman, who runs Beinman and Partner, he gets knighted. You know, if you look throughout the case, you'll see all of them have been risen to ranks. And meanwhile, they stepped it up because of the fact that they see that I'm going to expose them. They put a whole operation into place to keep me quiet and to create a diversion. When they, after the proceedings were lodged, most of them didn't answer it because they knew they were finished. So they were even too scared to even respond to it. And so at the time, I had to go to see the Masters, Chancery Masters in Thomas More Building. The case was in Royal Courts of Justice, which is in an area called the Strand in London, central London, and it's in an area called Holborn, Chancery. That's all where the courts are. That's all court country, you know what I mean? All law firms, you've right. got a lot of chambers there. For barristers' chambers, Lincoln's Inn, where Tony Blair's wife was, Sherry Blair. The whole area, in fact, it's very close to Fleet Street as well, which is the home of the media and the press and stuff like that. So that whole area is like Law Court, Fleet Street, Chambers, you know. Anyway, so I issued my case and automatically I was awarded default judgment, because if you don't answer a case within 28 days and you don't defend it, you know, you don't acknowledge it, you get default. The person suing gets automatic default judgment. So I had to go before the Chancery Masters, because initially I was going to make it a specified claim. Now, had it been a specified claim, how the law works is that automatically the courts would ask them, let's say I sued them, I put, they owe me £10. So the court would send out automatically a letter to them, you have to pay up the £10, right? But I had what was called an unspecified claim, because what the Chancery Masters said to me is that because of the scale of the money, the work being sold all over the world and cut up into God knows how many shows, and it was a book and it was also my multimedia platform, you know, not to make it specified claim, but to make it unspecified, and then we would go into court for an account of profits. So in other words, what would have to happen is that they would have to disclose how much they have made in revenue from the sale of my work in all the different countries, whether it be 126 or 168, which is indicated on the Berne Convention. You can check up the Berne Convention as well. So in short, I had to wait to see a judge in order to make orders for them to do this. And so the case that was supposed to be heard was to be heard in July 2005, right? So issued in 2004, and before, in actually in that time I was blacking out as well, as I told you. So the doctors were writing to the courts as the proceedings was, things were starting to move. The doctors said to me, they said, number one, when you get into court, don't drink any water. Believe me, they were so switched on. They said, never drink any water, because you know they give you a jug and a glass of water. Don't drink it, he said, because sometimes they can poison you. This is how switched on my doctors were. And my doctors wrote to the courts and said that I needed to have CAT scans and see MRI scans because I was blacking out. And they just wanted to make sure that I was strong enough to deal with the case, because at that time, as I said, you know, I had lost a lot of weight and my hair fell out and I was being watched. And they were just concerned for me. So they wrote all this information to the courts. And so the court stayed the case, and it was due to go back to court in July of 2005, right?
Right.
But what happened is, running up to July of 2005, there was a witch hunt to shut me up. So as I gathered the evidence they gathered, it got more and more violent as time went on, and it got more and more dangerous as time went on. And I started to, as I said, what they do is they employ ghostwriters. And as I said, they will get these ghostwriters to write out all the things that are factually taking place, and then they would make a TV program about it. So for instance, my medical records, when I went to the hospital to have a CAT scan, and what happens is you've got your appointment card, and also one of the lawyers that was involved was printed on the appointment card. So they issued a whole new style of appointment cards, and suddenly they were featured on my appointment card advertising. Oh. And it's that kind of thing. It's like, it's that's what my friend said, this is like Rosemary's Baby. It's like, it gets sinister. So the people that you're suing are now on your medical appointment card. And then when I go in, normally what they do is they go in and get your file while you're sitting in the waiting area. And they hand you your file, and then you go in to see the doctor with your file, right?
Right.
But only I wait for my file, and it doesn't exist. It's been stolen. So they steal my medical records. And what they do is they make a program about stealing a woman, this same woman, somebody dressed like me. And at the time, I was using a pseudo name. Because I realized that when you ring people up and you give your name, there's like a kind of, it gets flagged up straight away.
Yeah.
So, people said to me, don't give your name. If you try to find lawyers, don't give your name. So I was still seeking help at hearing because I was ill. And, so I was given the name Isabel at one point. And then what happened was they made a program about stealing Isabel's medical records and into her house, and they flung the records all over, and they were laughing like in this is what they were doing. Just everything they did to me, it was been made a program about. And I could not believe it. That's what made me ill. It made me I would just collapse. It was just so shocking to me. Until I developed, I climatized. I had to climatize, but that took years to climatize to where I am now. You know, because I never knew what evil was.
Yeah.
I never knew evil existed. I never knew. I mean, yeah, people lie and they cheat and they do horrible things, but I never knew people like this existed. It was like I was so shocked. I could not believe that this was even possible. Even the idea that they would use the media to rub what they was doing in, to gloat about it, and, you know, that's so criminal. And then I found out there are cases, in fact. There was a case in Colombia, I think it was. I think there's definitely been a case with the BBC, there's one case, but it's not this quite the same. But in this case in Colombia, there was like a TV show, TV network, and they were losing ratings, they were losing money, and the executive knew he was going to lose his job. So what he started to do, he started to pay criminals to carry out crime. And he made a kind of crime watch show. But little did the audience know that he was the one that was doing the crimes, you know. So this type of thing is really what they do. You know, they invent their own crimes. It's just like the false flags. They're staging it in their TV productions themselves, and they put it out there to people like, oh, terrorists are out there, you know what I mean? And it's actually them that is manufactured the whole thing. It's all completely hocus pocus. It's bogus.
Right. So you know, these guys invert everything. The people that you're supposed to respect and admire, like the knights, when the queen knights somebody, to me, it's like labeling them a scumbag. Because if you look at all the people that she's knighted, like there's Jimmy Savile, and I think she knighted the false Paul McCartney twice. I mean, it's like over there, the more high up you are in that government, the more of a scumbag you are. And I think it's true around the world. I think it's true in the U.S. government, too. It's just we've seen a lot of this U.K. because we've been involved in the Hampstead cover-up and now your situation. And
Well, actually, the area of Hampstead has been flagged up. It's full of these people. That's where they congregate. That's where they live. They all live in this Hampstead sort of area. This is what has been flagged up from other people. I heard a very good interview with someone called Mel Vey with Alfred Weber. She was talking about her. I saw that and I thought, okay. And she was talking about media as well, you know. Because she's got a background in media, and she's a very intelligent woman, you know. You can see she's extremely sharp, you know. And she was talking about it on that interview, and I thought, wow, she's picking it up. What's going on here? You know, so because what we're talking about is satanic ritual abuse. These people are Satanists, and this is why they get knighted and they whatever. Because the thing is, the higher up the chain you go, the more filthy it is.
Exactly.
And the more money involved, the more. This is why it's horrific in my case. If you go through my case, what they've done and the level of murders and everything, it's because the money, you know, the money is in the trillions. Like it created, if there's a there's an actual documentary which is on BBC, oh, is it on the BBC? It's called The Super Rich and the Greed Game. Now that program, if you watch it, it will tell you, and you'll see that it's Richard Branson, the same people, because what happened is NTL dissolved because I was coming with so much evidence, and they had been reported like many, many times for criminality and being a rogue company from 1999, which I found as evidence, and that was part of my evidence. They'd been reported to the ASA, Advertising Standard Agency. They'd been reported to FACT, which is the Federation Against Copyright Theft. They'd been reported to so many people. And, you know, so I had quite an arm, you know, a real massive amount of evidence coming from other people besides my own case to use. So what they did is they disbanded as NTL and they became Virgin Media, which they are today, and that is a criminal cartel of the highest order. The people, they sell the people products, they buy, people buy into their Virgin Media, what do you call it, broadband, and you know, they give you the fastest fiber optics and all the rest, and they make it the cheapest one possible. But the reality is that these people are murdering people around the world. And every time you buy a contract with Virgin Media, if you do not cancel your contract, you're basically saying you do not care that people are being murdered by this company, and this company needs to shut down. Because that's the only way you're going to protect yourself and your family from these psychopaths, is when, because this is their God. Their God is money. Their God is money. This is why we have to take the money off them. We have to take the money off them, and we have to put the money back into good causes. It has to be transmuted, all the blood money that they've done, that they've taken. We've got to change the energy and the energy of the currency to be about love, good, and, you know, justice and, you know, just health, you know, love, the way that it was intended to be. It's not intended to be this way. You know, because their heart, they know it's not theirs.
Right.
This is why they're using it for wicked. It's not from their soul. It doesn't come from them. This is why they have no respect for it. And they use it to destroy. If it had come from their hard labor and their own, they would treat it with more respect. They have no respect for it. Most of these people are cokeheads. Most of these people are drug abusers. Most of these people are psychopaths, what they get up to in behind the scenes. I don't even want to cast my mind what they're doing with the money. I just know that I'm charged to take that money back and put it back into humanity. That's what I'm charged with to do. So that's part of the job that I need everybody out there to do, you know, because we really shouldn't, none of us should be living in the poverty that we're living in. None of us. They're telling us about austerity, that there's no money. There's money. They've just stolen it. They want it for themselves. They want to impoverish everybody so that it's easy to enslave us all. That's what they want. And we have to change that. We have to change it quick. So let me go back to, I was talking to you about the fact that there are cases, actually, you know, of these TV networks, you know, fabricating and faking events so that they can create a TV show that will be a ratings winner. And in this particular case that I'm talking about, this man, he did go to prison in the end because he got busted. I don't know, he played with the wrong people anyway. And, you know, they basically investigated him. He probably was being investigated for some time. And then the police swarmed in and they got him, you know, because, I don't know, he was setting people up. As much as he was paying these criminals, he was setting people up, and it became a mess, you know, big hot mess. And this is what this is. This is a big hot mess right now. You know, even that shooting of the network, that was, you know, the picture. We've discovered that the picture, the front cover of the newspaper has a picture, and the woman who I think was apparently shot is holding a microphone that says 7/7 on it.
Oh, no.
Yeah, you'll see it. It's like blatant. It's absolutely blatant. It's like, this is what happens. Every single time I've done like interviews, like, because I after Alfred, I didn't make any interviews for a long time, and I was ill for about 2 months. I was being attacked. I was having my electrical supply siphoned off. You know, I had two men turn up in here where I'm staying, and they took out the fuse box, the electrical fuse box, and they've replaced it with an industrial scale commercial one, you know, like God knows how many times its size. And then all of a sudden, first my eyes were streaming and I was getting these headaches, and then the electric supply was being siphoned. So no matter how much money you went in, you put in the machine, because it's a pay-as-you-go system, you know, you'd never have any electricity. So effectively, I was paying for my own demise, you know.
Yeah.
And, yeah, so, you know, that's how I spent most of this year, with no electricity, no food, no what have you, you know. I'm here and there. People sent me £10. Some people sent me £30, you know. So I was able to here and there put, but the money, we put in it back in the machine, and it was stealing the electrical supply. You know, in the end, I just thought, we're going to shut this donation page down, shut it, because, you know, what they do, they always find a way to take it somewhere, you know. I managed to buy a computer, and then the computer, they zapped it, and they took the whole operating system.
That sounds horrible. It sounds like they were targeting you with one of those low-frequency waves. I was thinking they were probably doing that when you were suffering vertigo in the beginning of this case.
Yeah, there was something going on. But you see, at that time, the enormity of all the layers of the onion, you know, I mean, I was just dealing with the first-hand stuff, the fact that I was getting death threats. And because what they do, they pile it on. So you don't have, you're just basically like running for your life. And obviously, the time that I had available, I studied, you know, I was studying law, proceedings, you know. So I channeled my anger, you know, I channeled it into making sure that I would put them behind bars. And I took one of the largest lawsuits ever to be seen on record by a single person, and I won, you know. And then because I won, they covered it up. But anyway, so running up to the case now, they were obviously panicking. Because of you got to see the motive. You know, you're talking shareholders. Let's say it's not 126 countries, it's 168 countries, like the Berne Convention states.
Right.
You know, this is a treaty that's signed by 168 countries specifically for the kind of free flow of intellectual property and putting everybody on the same level playing field as far as the law is concerned, establishing ownership rights and all those things. So obviously, because they were doing an operation that was global, you know, they would have to create some sort of playing field to secure the revenue, and also to make shareholders feel comfortable, because these are all big networks. There was lots of mergers done at the time, new companies formed in order to steal copyrights, and also they expanded the operations for organized IP crime. Now, I need to make the distinction, because it's not copyright. You have copyright infringement, you have copyright theft, and then you have organized IP crime. Each of those have different categories. Copyright infringement could be deemed as somebody, copyright infringement could be deemed as copying a YouTube video. Yeah, so that would be deemed as a copying a YouTube video or uploading somebody's music, etc. that's copyright infringement. Even though the person, you know, they probably don't intend to. They just love the music. They uploaded it and it's got music on it. So it will be flagged up and YouTube might send you a notice that you got to pay, you know, pay copyright, you know, whatever. So, and, you know, rightly so, artists should be paid for what they create. And more often than not, the people who benefit from artists' copyright ownership is not the creator. The real creators are the real copyright owners. But you'll see in real terms, the people that more often than not own copyright are not the creators, are the business people, the managers, the corrupt lawyers, the corrupt publishing houses, the corrupt business institutions. They are the ones that are benefiting from people's copyrights, which lasts, I think it's 70 years plus or whatever, depends. I think they're trying to expand it because, you know, what would happen is things like Walt Disney's work would go become public in the public domain, and they want to be able to own it for longer. So because intellectual property is the equivalent to real estate. It's the equivalent to real estate. It's just valued much more because of the fact that, it, you know, millions of people buy into a copyright. So you'll have millions of people listening to one piece of music. So obviously there's more revenue than one house that's been made, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, so, yeah, I understand.
Yeah, so, but then when you deal with copyright theft has intention behind it. And this is why it was established in cases such as the one that I cited in my court case, which is called RV versus Willits. And in that case, it was in 1901. In 1901, there were operations to steal print music. Now, we're talking at the time of people like Scott Joplin, Ragtime, and that kind of thing. You'd get people that would steal printed music and they'd farm it out, and that's how they would infringe copyright. And it was established because of the scale of operations. It's this equivalent to bootlegging or whatever. You know, they established there's a criminal element to copyright. So that comes into play. So as much as you get civil charges, so you'd have to pay damages for pecuniary losses, actual losses, exemplary losses, aggravated losses, loss of profits, loss of chance, restitutionary losses, disgorgement losses. You'd have to pay a number of different losses to the IP owner in order to put the person back into the position they would have been had you not stolen their work. And also, you know, people have to pay out money to pay for their claims in court, and, you know, their lives go downhill while they're fighting proceedings. They're usually dragged out for many, many decades. So, you know, the damages are designed to correct all that on a civil level. But because it's established that it is crime as well, you know, people do get murdered, etc. That was established by the case that made precedent in 1901. So it's been long established that copyright is not just about just the civil side of it. It also can be deemed criminal activity. And so when you get into that side, you're getting into the organized IP crime. So it's organized crime that the thing that's being peddled on this occasion is not weapons, it's intellectual property. Because it has the largest market revenue, it's probably the largest market revenue for anything. That's why when you look at some of the flights that have gone down in Malaysia, what's it?
MH17 and M370, I think, MH370.
Yeah, right. When you look at those, if you recall, there was like 20 software engineers on the plane. And also, you know, the patents were withdrawn, not withdrawn, they were purchased the following day when all these people died, you know, and apparently there was another recent one with 74 scientists on the plane. So when you see these sort of things happen, then because most people are not aware of this secret menace, they don't connect it because it is terrorism. You know, it's industrial espionage, it's domestic terrorism, it's all these things, it's organized IP crime. And because people are not aware of what these people do in organized IP crime, they might look at it as an isolated incident. Oh, that was a plane, why did the plane go down? And they won't connect the fact that there was 20 software engineers on the flight. You know, that's no coincidence. And then the following day, patents which are worth billions of pounds are automatically bought up and owned by people, you know. So, you know, it tells you, you know, hold on a minute. Let's start looking in a whole new direction when we start looking at these false flags. You've got to peel back the onion. And in many cases, like if you look at, is it the Batman shooting in Colorado,
yeah.
Aurora.
And then if you look at the Sandy Hook situation, you'll see on both of those cases, there's a court case, which was to do with the LIBOR scandal. You know, both of the sons, both of the young men they named were actually the sons of witnesses in the LIBOR scandal.
Whoa.
And what they, I didn't know that.
Yeah. Yeah, and most people are not aware of that. Adam Lanza and James Holmes, I believe their names were.
Right.
And they make it look like a lone psychopath or what have you. But if you actually look behind the scenes, both of them had fathers in the LIBOR scandal, which the LIBOR scandal is the London International Overnight Exchange Rate. I've forgotten the proper, what's the B stands for? LIBOR. International... Sorry, the London International, it's to do the overnight exchange rate. Check it out. Anyway.
Yeah.
I can't remember it off the top of my head, but, you know, if you type it in, you'll find out what the actual acronym stands for. And, you know, you'll find that a lot of these things are connected to court cases, you know, and they are smoke screens for terrorist organizations. And then if you look into what was going on with HSBC, they were funding terrorism. And you start connecting the dots and you'll start realizing, holy moly, how did we miss that?
Right.
Right. You know, and this is why they will try to smear me, because what they don't want is people connecting the dots, because this is a massive industry. It's an industry, what they do to people with IP crime. And as I said, they're terrorists, they're domestic terrorists. But in order to, because they carry out acts of terror in order to create smoke screens and diversion tactics so that people stop, you know, listening and paying attention to the people that are involved. And then you look at the people involved, they're all connected to boiler rooms, which is involved in money laundering. You know, you see one company has got like, you know, I don't know, thousands and thousands of people connected to that one company with one address. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's all do with, it's all to do with organized crime and embezzlement on a massive scale and money laundering. Right now, London and the UK is the money laundering capital of the world. It is the place where you go to clean money. It is, property is being used as, you know, they're buying up properties quickly to clean money. You know, it's massive. So you have like the onion, then you go into it deeper, then you'll see, okay, who's doing these things? And then you realize they're Satanists. So on one level, you're seeing some of the satanic activities, but then on the financial level, you'll see behind my case, this is the financial side of it, you know, that people haven't connected the dots to, because this is how they compromise people in positions of power. You know, you'll find that a lot of the people that are pedophiles or whatever, they're all part of the industry, they're actors, they're, you know, they're in it in some way. You know, there's a direct link. And, you know, sadly, there's people that believe in order to, you know, they want access to that money and they want to get into the $1 million club and the $1 billion club. And so they'll kind of do anything to do that. And, you know, the sad thing is, this is how short-sighted these people are, because if only they were to consider that if they, you know, people like me will fund people to make money in industry, we will create industry for everybody. We will create hospitals, cures for autism. We would. This is another reason why they don't want me to have anything, and they want to get rid of me, because they know that it will undo their nefarious plans, you know, their Luciferian agenda. You know, my agenda is to bring God people and God kingdom back on earth. You know, we have to bring it back on earth. We have to create love, unity, and, you know, help each other. And, you know, with money, I mean, money's a tool for an end. Ideally, we wouldn't need money at all. We'd just barter our skills. But the reality is, right now, they have the money belonging to myself and other people in their bank accounts. In my case, I've got documentation, I've got audios to prove that it's my money. And they don't want to give it to me. And that money's to be used for humanity. So this is another reason why we're calling for people to come forward to get the money, you know, from these people, so that we can shut them down and reverse what they've done, you know, as quickly as possible. So to go back into the story, so are you still there? Are you still
with me? we're right with you. We understand that this is a big global satanic network. And the entertainment industry, which is the media, is really the epicenter of the whole thing. When the people get into that media, they lose their souls, they lose their opinions. We're putting together another video where we're having big name stars are coming out and advocating this aspects of Agenda 2030. And these people, they don't have an opinion. All they have to do exactly what they're told. Yeah, it may look like they're rich and famous and glamorous, but they're not. They're slaves.
They're highly paid slaves. I was just about to say that. Yeah. They're highly paid slaves, and no disrespect to anybody out there, but money doesn't make you a man. Money doesn't give you power. Your divinity is, this is why we are individuals. We're in inner divine duels, duels even, of the Most High Creator, you know. So, you know, the thing is that once you lose your ability to be authentic, you lose your integrity, you lose your dignity as a soul, as a divine soul. Once you lose your ability to speak freely, to live freely, you are nothing more than a slave. Exactly. If you can't say certain things because of fear of death, that makes you a slave. You know, anybody in that industry, they have to ask themselves, can I talk freely? If you say no, then you know that you're a slave.
Exactly.
Somebody's pulling your strings. And somehow, you have to cut that. You have to be able to unplug from that. And the only way is by each of the individuals, the divine sacred beings out there, have to say, I don't choose slavery for myself or anybody else. Because they think, oh, you know, we're enslaving the masses and we're part of the, you know, billion dollar club. But in reality, you're not. Because you're as dispensable as Michael Jackson, Whitney Houston, Bobby Christina, and, you know, all the other great legends that has come, Sam Cooke, James Brown, and you know, the list is endless.
And they dispense with them in such a disgusting way. I mean, if you look at what they did to Jimi Hendrix, it's just horrible. And then you have people like, you know, while you were going over these bailiffs that were irritating you.
Yeah.
This is where most people are. They think they're following orders. Oh, I'm just following orders. And he's a low-paid nobody. These bailiffs are nobody. They're just following orders. But they're responsible for what they do. I mean, they're just following orders, but that doesn't excuse them.
For
being Satan's little
henchmen,
exactly.
Mm.
So
that's what they are, you know, and they're doing it for trinkets, you know. I mean, when you look at the trolls and the agents and shills and people that go around writing nasty things on people's comments, spreading negativity and hatred, you know, you look it into, because there's, if you type in, on one level, if you type in targeted individual, you get loads up. And more and more these days, people are coming forward with intellectual property, you reckon. So it's starting to hit the kind of, you know, it's starting to get out there. But then on the other level, the people that are the gang stalkers who carry out the gang stalking against the person to harass us and to terrorize us on a daily basis, they're called perps, perpetrators. And they're doing it sometimes for welfare.
Exactly.
And they get, like, you know, money to go and shop in this place and, you know, Walmart or wherever.
Yeah.
Trinkets. And, you know, there's no dignity. Everything is energy, as we know. And everything you touch that is filthy leaves a stain on you. And if you engage in these activities, you live your life having to watch over your shoulder, because these people will kill you. Once they start paying you to do these operations and to write nasty things and assassinate people's characters, people like Mark Windows and Deborah, there's a woman, Deborah Williams, and these are people I don't know, these people. They came out and said I was this, that, and the other, and I was a liar. I've never met half of these people in my life. I'm like, obviously, these are either crackheads or what they are. But, you know, the reality is it's dirty money, it's blood money, it's trap money, it's trick money. It's designed to trap you and entrap you. So you think that you've got an advantage and they're offering you monies to carry out and you're going to have money in your bank account. Maybe you haven't had any money. This is why poverty is an industry. They keep people poor so that you will go out and do these dirty things for them. But consider this. These people are doing it and it's not their money. Now, if you worked for people like us, you would be doing things with honor to help other people. You know, so you keeping us targeted doesn't benefit you in the long run, because you could make money working in a legitimate organization. You know, when we have our money back in our account, we can employ, we can create industry, we can create a revenue where we fund people, credit people properly, where people do honorable work, you know, and that you don't have to look over your shoulder. Nobody's going to kill you for, you know. And so by keeping that machine going, you're stopping yourself, you're preventing yourself from having an opportunity to work and earn even more money in a very healthy way that's going to help not just you and your family, but lots of other families, you know. So by kind of going along to get along and by sneaking a little piece of the crumb here and there and everywhere where you can get it, you're shooting yourself in the foot.
Right.
And you're putting yourself in danger. And this is what people have to recognize before they take on these jobs. You know, they would be much better to train themselves to become a sheriff or, you know, a bailiff on behalf of the people, rather than behalf of these banks that are stealing and asset stripping on behalf of Agenda 21. Instead of actually working for these people who are stealing from the rest of us, the traffic and the energy flow of currency has to be diverted back to the right people, because the right people will behave with honor. You know, these people are not honorable because they know it's not theirs. They know it's not theirs. They know they've acquired this wealth by, you know, unjustified means. They've got unjust riches, ill-gotten gains, and the proceeds of crime. You know, however, those same people, if we got rid of them, we got the money back, we could employ people to do good things, to protect people from being targeted. That's a better way to make money, rather than spying on people and actually making money, because these people don't carry out their their dirty work for themselves. No, they just don't. Pick up the phone and they issue out checks, our checks.
Right.
It's not even their money. They issue out checks. They go around with the delusional idea that they've got some form of power when there's no power there because there's no honor there. Honor and power are synonymous. There is no power. Unless you are honorable and just in your conduct, there is no power. The crown symbolizes the crown chakra. The crown chakra is the highest form of divine knowledge to be bestowed on an individual. And so when you are bestowed with that knowledge, the crown is invisible. It's symbolic. What they're wearing is the crown. They're putting it on their head because they don't have it. They right. don't have it. The people that wear the crown really are it. The ones that wear it are in. It's an invisible crown. It is the activated crown chakra. And that what they've done is they've changed all the archetypes. So, you know, people consider a crown to be a physical object. It is not a physical object. It's a divine thing, you know, and it's to do with divine enlightenment, you know, intelligence from a divine source, you know, wisdom. You cannot be a ruler without having accountability and to be wise. You know, this is why Solomon was considered to be a wise ruler, because he was, you know, he had knowledge because he had wisdom, until he let go of the things that he was, you know, told to do. And then he took up with Sheba. This is in the story, right?
Yeah.
And she was a Baal worshipper. And then that's how his kingdom became destroyed, because he stopped following what God had prescribed for him. And this is what happens when we do not follow the rules that are the divine source, the natural laws, you know, cosmic laws. They're all bestowed as a manual for humanity to live in harmony and peace with one another. This is why we have those things, and we have to take them into our hearts and take it very, very seriously, you know. And this is what we have to put those doctrines back into practice. We have to, first of all, we have to make sure that we honor them ourselves before we point to anybody else and say, you know, you're wrong, or, you know, blame people, whatever. You got to make sure that you're practicing what you're preaching yourself. And a lot of the time we see that there's a lot of people out there that they're talking about things, but when you look at their own conduct, they're not just. I've dealt with people who have got cases and they've treated me unjustly, you know, and yet they're complaining about justice not being in the country. Don't point your finger out there unless you're just yourself, you know, because otherwise you're just misleading people and you're misleading yourself. And so that's another thing that we have to take on board. We have to start looking at our own conduct and our own hearts, and how do we treat people ourselves, you know, each one of us, you know. We can't always look at money as power. People say, call these people rulers. They're not rulers. They are not our rulers. They are usurpers. This is what people have to remember. They are usurpers. They're not supposed to be there. And there is a remedy for a usurper. We are the rulers. We are the sovereign people. We are the rulers of these people. Anybody working within the police or working within the courts, the judiciary, within government, they are called public servants. They are the servants, right? And they're right. trying to make us into their servants, but that's not really in real terms. They are the servants and we are the rulers. But it's just that people are not standing in their power to assert their divine right. And that's why if there were more people issuing proceedings against these people, they would have been put in prison a long time ago. Unfortunately, they've set up a whole system that you have to go to the police if somebody does something to you, or you have to go to a lawyer. Most of these lawyers only defend cases. They do not prosecute cases. They do not give them licenses to prosecute. So you'll go from lawyer to lawyer to lawyer, and they'll tell you the same thing. Sorry, we don't prosecute. And then you'll go to the Crown Prosecution Service, and it's up to them, to their discretion, whether or not they're going to take proceedings and sue these people. Most of the time, these people are part of the network. and they've put their people in there to be the gatekeepers. So in short, you've handed over your power to one organization, another organization, and another organization. None of these organizations care about any one of us. So when I go in there and I say, this is happening to me, you know, they could not give a damn. As long as these people pay them money and they can go out and hire hookers and they can pay for champagne parties and cocaine parties and whatever else indulgences they like, whether it be little children or whatever sickness that they have going on in their mind, they will take the money and do it so that they can live in that filth, in that cesspit, because it's a cesspit full of worms. And right now, the way to change it is that we have to, first of all, change the awareness, the understanding that people have to recognize that they are the rulers. Stop calling these people rulers. They are not. Stop calling them elite. They are criminals. They're not elite. They're criminals, and they're people that should be put behind bars for their own safety, if not for everybody else's safety. We are relying on organizations that have no care and consideration for humanity. The real archetype of a police officer is an angel. The real proper archetype of what a police officer or a judge or any of people in those positions to be guardians of the people, the proper one is to look at Archangel Michael. That is the archetype of a police officer, right? But what's happened now, we see that thuggery, brutality, criminality, wickedness is synonymous with a police officer. And that's not the real archetype. These people are supposed to be the closest thing to an angel that you'll find on planet Earth. And that is the truth. And we have to recognize that. We have to start to put things in their proper categories. We have to define it as it is, call it what it is, so that we can stop this nonsense of all these rulers. Because once you call somebody a ruler, you're disempowering yourself. I am my ruler. God gives me the power to rule and govern over myself. And I'm lucky to... Sorry?
No, that's really good. This last 10 minutes has been so inspiring. I hope that we can get a lot of people to hang in through all the way so that they can hear that wonderful, it's like a soliloquy you did at the end there.
Thank you.
We're going to have to end at 7. Do you want to say something? I want to encourage whistleblowers, but what else would you like to say?
Okay, just to fast track into the, just to let people know the fast track version, because I'm on the divine download. I let it come out, whatever has to come out, the message for the people, to, you know, inspire and plant seeds out there so that we can take back our sovereignty and be sacred beings. But just quickly, I speed through. So I tried to stop the London bombings. I became aware of it in around May of 2005, running up to proceedings. I tried to take injunctions to stop it. I went to the magistrate's court. I spoke to a man called Charles Rees. I was in tears. He was shocked. He looked at the evidence and he knew I was telling the truth. He said, you've got to take proceedings against the police to make them take proceedings against the cartel to stop them. And there wasn't enough time. And in short, I had to end up in hiding, which is where I was from June of 2005, mid-June, till I got smuggled to police station on the 31st of August. In 2005, I got smuggled to Notting Hill Gate Police Station because it was my birthday, and one of the witnesses, who happens to be my relative, said, you can't stay in here anymore. While the bombings took place, they came into the building, they shoved papers underneath the door, one of those bailiff's letters, but it had the date of the bombings to let me know it was them that did it. Mm. And as you know, they shot the guy with my name, the Brazilian, John Charles Menendez, to warn me to keep my mouth shut. My street was on CNN news. I couldn't believe it. I collapsed. I was on the floor and I had to move very quickly, and I wrote to all sorts of places, mosques and, you know, all kinds of Quakers, and I don't know. I mean, I wrote to hundreds of people, sent letters, and people were sending letters out for me. Eventually, after I got smuggled, I got into court, and that's how I basically, when I got back to court, I found that they had removed my case illegally from the court lists. So obviously the intention was to kill me and remove the case, but it didn't. They didn't anticipate that I would go into hiding. I didn't plan for that. It was just divinely inspired. Just like yesterday, I was told in the spirit to run, you know. On
yeah.
that occasion, I was told, don't leave, you know. So I barricaded myself inside and I remained inside for 3 months. I've been in hiding 3 times since. I met Tony Farrell in 2012 at a demonstration. There's a video of it. If you type in IPCC, Independent Police Complaints Commission, demonstration on the 1st of May, and you just put my name next to it. I did speak longer, but for some reason, they only put up 3 minutes of what I said.
Wow.
I pretty much said exactly what I said here, and Tony Farrell, who happened to be a whistleblower of South Yorkshire Police, is also a Christian and a very God-fearing man. And he asked me, he said, wow, you know, who are you? You know, can I see your evidence? And when I showed him the evidence, he could not believe it. And that was the beginning of what became the report, which is on a website, thefarrellreport.net. And it is a report, I'm highlighting my case and its links to the London bombings. Also, you will see court documents for anybody that wants to look at. Not the whole case is not up there because there were 14 witnesses, but you'll get a good, you know, you'll get majority of the documents, Skellington arguments, affidavits, and what was the, you know, the pleadings, etc. And there's also courtroom audios. After I won the case, they forged the documents, they covered it up, and the judge was mysteriously pronounced dead. And I fought for a further 2 years. I got the courtroom audios, and then they made a gagging order. A corrupt judge called Lawrence Collins made a gagging order to make sure that nobody ever hears my courtroom audios, which prove not only that I won, but any attempt to dismiss my case would put the whole judiciary in serious breach of the law. And so, you know, they got this judge who was Pinochet, the actual dictator. He used to be his lawyer.
Oh no.
And yeah, Augustus Pinochet's lawyer, Lawrence Collins, that's who he is. And they appointed him specifically with the job of actually covering up my courtroom audios. And we reported them to the police, and then I was put onto a eternal targeting program. So in order to stay alive, I've had to go into hiding twice for 6 months. And, you know, to try to get the message out there of what was being done to me. I had people that eventually saw some of the things I posted on a site called Lawful Rebellion. It's probably still up there. And I got rescued out of that situation by some wonderful, wonderful people. And so, yeah, that's basically how I kind of got out, and since that time I've been an advocate of the truth behind the London bombings, protection for creative people, particularly targeted individuals. I'm a number one spokesman on that subject, along with all the number one spokespeople on the subjects, like wonderful Alfred Weber and Tony Farrell. Tony Farrell has been smeared. He's been, you know, they literally tried to destroy him to stop him making the report. So I'm eternally grateful to him. he didn't know me from Adam, and you know, he took it upon himself because of his love of God to do this, and you know, he got a lot of flack for it. So you know, that shows that he's a big person in my eyes. And now we're in a position where we have targeted individuals who are have been contacting me around the world, also musicians who want to lend their hands and join the army. There is a brilliant show called the Reggae Business Talk Show, which talks about how to protect yourself if you're a creative person. I did that show a couple of Sundays ago, and that was episode 10, but there are some brilliant shows that break down everything from your publishing to how to protect yourself, how to, if you've had a hit record, never been paid, how to get your royalties back, you know, and all that sort of great stuff. And at the moment they deal with the reggae side of the industry, but they're expanding, you know, because they realize that it's so much bigger. You know, music connects to film and music and movies and TV, etc. So that's where we are. We're building a global army. If anybody wants to join hands with us, hearts with us, to shut this down. I'm not going to entertain anybody who's going to try to do any form of trickery. I'll catch you out quickly. And if I catch you, you'll be on the register and named. We'll find out exactly who you are, exactly where you're from, and I will put your name on the register. So please don't send me any nasty messages. I've already been through enough. My parents, as you know, my mother said she ate a banana, and she died suspiciously, like all of a sudden. There was nothing wrong with her. She was not a sick person. On the 2nd of January last year, my father was not feeling well. He went into hospital. He was trying to leave the hospital, and then they basically kept him in. The next thing we know, he was dead. Yeah. And in both of those scenarios, everybody around them, either one of my parents, they were separated. They've been separated for many years. So it's completely separate situations, but both of my parents in the same year. That's no coincidence. I'm sorry. I'm coming after whoever has harmed my parents. That's what I'm letting people know. My friends, one of them, Malcolm Moore, he was a pastor, Christian pastor, extremely talented man. He was the creator of the Toy Story film franchise. And he was in the film, and he made films, documentaries. He died on the bus, believe it or not. He was sitting on the bus and he
died. Wow.
That happened in 2012 on the 17th of May. Same day, another friend of mine, who happens to be a friend of mine, died on the same day, same time as Malcolm. But he died in the hospital. I believe they killed him in the hospital. There's been a wake of deaths. There's been Sarah Mulvey. All the people associated with the sale of the work of all this, many of the, can't say all, but many of the executives, just to correct myself, quite a number of executives from Sarah Mulvey. She was 26 years old when she was roped into this. It seems to me that she refused to play the game anymore, and she died in 2010. She was taking proceedings against the networks for bullying. It seems like initially it must have been fun. She was risen to the ranks as a high-flying executive. And then she died in 2010 when she tried to take proceedings towards these bullies in the networks because she wouldn't play the game anymore. You can Google her name, Sarah Mulvey, M-U-L-V-E-Y. Then there's Richard Hopkins. He was connected to selling of my work. Age 48, I believe. Again, another death. There's another man called James Wood, I believe. Another death connected with Strictly Come Dancing. Just to let people know what my works are, Dancing with Stars in the USA, Strictly Come Dancing in the UK. That those franchises are all over the world. There's You Are What You Eat, 10 Years Younger, Diet Doctors, Cosmetic Surgery Live, Fitness, show, Fit Farm. I mean, there's a long, long list of famous TV productions which are still running. They're still collecting the revenue for, and this revenue is funding the false flag, stage false flag operations that you see today. So in a nutshell, that's kind of to summarize quickly. There will be a lot of other shows. Stay tuned on Alfred's channel and some other channels that will be putting out the story. When I do videos, usually I show documents. So check out Alfred's channel shortly, yeah?
Right.
Yeah, so that's where we are. We are going to be doing a live event. Let me just quickly say this.
Okay.
We're doing a live event. We want to try to transmute the energy because they've used my name for Charlie Hebdo, which means Charlie 7. Hebdo means 7. And, we want to change the vibration. And we've got artists coming forward. So we want to have like events in 7 countries, 7 artists and speakers to perform in 7 countries over a period of 7 days. And we'll do it in concession. So you have part 1, part 2, part 3, part 4. So even if you can't be on part 1, you could maybe be on part 2. We're not sure how frequently, whether it's going to be something that we do every 3 months, every few weeks. It will be primarily an online thing. So it would be shown online rather than a concert type thing that people buy tickets for. It's not going to be that type of thing. It's going to be people united against IP crime to put this on the map under the Seven Gate situation. So, and Seven Gate is like Watergate. So if anybody's a musician, an artist or a speaker that would like to speak, or if you'd like to set up an event in your country where you are, because we want to do it in 7 countries each time. So say for instance, it will start in the UK, maybe the following day it will be in Germany, next day it will be in Mexico, the next day it will be a performance, will be, if you get the picture, that's kind of how it will run.
Yeah.
And yeah, so that's picking up interest. We've got some amazing people been in contact, really brilliant artists. So there's a lot of good stuff like that. As I said, we're going to be doing a register, official register. So if you're targeted out there, get in contact with me at 7gate, 2015 at gmail.com. At the moment, it's Gmail. They've closed down all my other accounts. I will change it soon. But for now, you can reach me 7gate2015 at gmail.com. And 7gate at Facebook. You go to Facebook/7gate. There are sites that say Charlie 7, but it's not me. They've set up all these other Facebook pages with my name, but it's not me at all. So don't go to them. Only go to the one where you see my picture and it's 7gate. And I have to say a big thank you to the guys that have been running that. There's Shuni and Brian. That's amazing, amazing friends of mine who've helped me, you know, to put the Facebook and keep it running while I've been under attack, etc. So that's it.
Thank you very much. This was so, so entertaining and informative. I really appreciate you spending time with us and getting this word out. We really have to get this under control and then stop it. I think the dam is breaking. So if I were a potential whistleblower, I would come forward. Listen, none of our lives are worth much if this continues. You don't have much of a future if it continues the way it is. And I'd like to also invite Seven back to talk to us again, maybe do a show on your spiritual journey during this whole ordeal
right.
that you've gone through.
So, right, that would be brilliant. Thank you. I'd also love to go on with Rainetta, who did the Kindle, because you'll see that there's a parallel between what's happened to her. She's been targeted for the last 15 years, and she has been through hell on earth as well, and nobody knows that she's the brains behind the Kindle and a lot of innovations that are out there that people are purchasing. And she's been tortured to death for these things, you know. And so I want to, I would love to be able to come on with her, and also maybe for her to come on and tell her own story as well, if you have the time and
Great.
availability.
Well, we'll
Is
just
that
set,
okay?
that's right. We'll set that up as soon as possible because we're interested in stopping this as much as you are.
Thank you. Thank you. I
Thank
really
you.
appreciate that.
Thank you
Okay, and
so
I'll
much,
have to
Sally.
thank you. Thank you for having me and giving me the divine opportunity to share. I really, really appreciate. I appreciate the work outside of, doing this today, all your great work with all the people that you put on your show, because it's not an easy job, to do, to bring this stuff out, but it's something that must be done, and it's people like you that help to change things, And so I want to send you lots and lots of love and, massive thank you for that. And I really appreciate everything that you're doing.
Well, thank you.
So
That's what we do it for. We do it for love. So,
that's what better cause is there in
that's
life?
right.
There's no better cause,
No better
really.
cause.
Thank you very much,
All
Seven.
right.
We'll talk to
Bless
you
you,
later.
Seven. We'll talk to you real soon. And you take care of
Okay, thank
yourself.
you. All right, take care.
Take
Take care. Much
too.
love to
Much love
everybody
back
out
to
there.
you.
Be safe and protect each other. Spread love. Remember, they're spreading hate, so it's up to us to spread love.
Yeah.
Do something good for somebody. Check up on your neighbors, see if they're all right. Old people, elderly, and make sure that you send love to people on a daily basis. Tell people you love them in your family. Your friends, make something for somebody, your shopkeepers. Spread love, spread the energy of love. That's the most
Absolutely.
powerful tool we have to, obliterate their evil. So, on that note, I'm going to bid you all farewell. Bye for now.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.